I've asked Professor Young to do the official introduction this evening, but I just want to take 1 minute to welcome you all to our first Monday lecture. I think we're very privileged to have Mr. Paul Friedberg, landscape architect. I wanted to be sure that we gave a special welcome to all our friends and other departments on the campus, architects, and especially landscape architects to this program. I wanted to also put a plug in for all those first and second year students in landscape architecture who are finally seeing the light. And with that, I'd like to introduce Dan Young, who will introduce our speaker this evening.
And I'd like to introduce Don Collins, who would introduce... No, I won't. It's a rare privilege for me to introduce M. Paul Friedberg this evening. I met Paul in North Carolina State University at the School of Design 3 years ago when he came down to lecture to the students. I remember what a provocative guy he was then, and this evening when we were meeting just prior to this at dinner, I had that whole thing reinforced to me, so I think you're in for a great treat this evening. To quickly get over this task, there were so many things that you could say about Paul, and I know he's not one to sort of dabble or play games with words, but Paul is the principal and partner in charge of designing and planning in his own firm, M. Paul Friedberg Associates, in New York City. He's a graduate of Cornell University, is a registered landscape architect in 3 states. And at the present time, I know that there's a great deal of pressure on him because he's starting a brand new program in landscape architecture at the City College of New York. And they're trying to get that program going, trying to keep his practice going, and some other commitments that he has. So he's really being hassled and harassed. So we're, I think, very privileged to have him come out here to Boston, find his way to Muncie and to Ball State University. Mr. Friedberg has been an active delegate member, I think it's important to mention a few things, an active delegate member to the White House Conference on Natural Beauty in 1965, to the New York State Conference on Natural Beauty in 1966, the Urban America Conference in Washington, D.C. in 1966, he is a professional consultant to the Public Housing Authority in Washington, D.C., and was this year appointed to the Art Commission in the City of New York. He this summer attended or came to Ball State as part of his duty as a consultant to housing, the Department of Housing and Urban Development, for the program which we have a research grant being sort of run by Marv Rosenman, Old Life for New Schools in the Burris. The Burris School is the subject of that, and Paul is a consultant.
The other way around, yeah.
I'd like to introduce Marv.
No? Okay.
It's the other way around, okay? He has been a guest lecturer and critic to many of, I think, the finest design schools across this country, and as well as being an active participant in significant design conferences, of which there are many, and they seem to, when you get involved, super as involved as Paul is, they seem to want to eat you up and take all of your time. He has received several professional awards, and there are many, but I just wanted to mention a few that I felt were significant because I have been, I think, very, very affected in my young professional design career by some of the theories that once again I felt tonight were being reinforced to me. And some of those is a landscape architect, the American Society of Landscape Architecture Honor Award in 1970, one of, I think, the most significant projects he's worked on, the Bedford-Stuyvesant Superblock in New York, the Housing and Urban Development Honor Award for 1966, and for the Reese Plaza project in New York City, received several awards. That's a I think an extremely fine and very, very capable kind of a solution. And I know that he's having some feelings about it in retrospect, and we were talking about that this evening. As a designer, how do you gain that kind of knowledge and information about human behavior as a designer? The New York Council of the Arts Award for that project in 1967, the New York Municipal Arts Society Merit Award in 1967, the AIA Honor Award, all for the Reese Plaza project. And finally, the ASLA Honor Award for the public school number 166 in 1968. I think many things have been written about Mr. Friedberg's work in professional journals, and he himself has been a significant writer on the condition of the urban open space. Two of the most important publications, I feel, personally, as a landscape architect, are the recent provocative books, Play and Interplay, published last year, and Playgrounds for City Children, published in 1969. Mr. Friedberg is an observer of the consequences, I think, of the artificiality and the increasing artificiality of our urban condition, and has repeatedly pointed out that our cities are creating, quotes, facilities today that don't respond to more than the smallest of our needs. And this evening, I think, will share with us on his perceptions on the dynamics of urban open space. Mr. Paul Friedberg.
That's a terrifying introduction. I think I just set off the buzzer. The dynamics of our PA system here.
You may want to stand over here a bit and see.
Is that better? I've never been forced to stand in one spot on a podium yet. I guess you have to. Okay, I'm here. I felt like you gave half a lecture. Subjective. Did you ever know your place? This is my place. I'm a landscape architect. Landscape architects are a profession. They comprise a profession that are rather strange to most people. I work in cities. People say, how can you work in cities? Where are the gardens? I say, you don't quite understand. Can you hear me? Can you hear me? Can you hear me now? Is that better? Let me take this thing off. I was going to try and do it without hands. They say, how can you be a landscape architect working in a city? And I say, you don't quite understand what landscape architects do. And there's a small story that goes with that. And landscape architects, as I explained, are in between, they're a bastard profession, they're in between engineers and architecture. They're that part of both professions that neither want to deal with. The architect builds a building, doesn't want to know what happens outside the building, and therefore he gives that responsibility over to a landscape architect. And the engineers have basically the same idea, and that part of engineering that they don't wish to deal with, they have allowed the profession of landscape architecture to pick up. So people say, well, if it's the leftovers that you deal with, how come you're in that profession? Why don't you go into architecture or engineering? And then I tell them the story. Guy walks into a bar, and the bartender, it's a landscape architect's joke. The bartender has his back turned, turns around and says, Jesus Christ, what is that smell? That's me. He said, I smell like that. I said, how do you smell like that? He says, well, see, I work in a circus, see, and I give enemas to elephants, and I'm up on this platform, and I don't always get out of the way in time. What a terrible thing to do, he says. Why don't you get another job? I'll give you a job here. And the guy looks at him rather hurt, and he says, what, and quit show business? Sorry. Here we are. Sorry. Well, There is great validity to landscape architecture. Sorry. And it's going to hamper my style. There is a great validity. It's a growing validity. The work that we do in cities is becoming more valid because people are becoming more aware that the outdoor environment is now what we know as the public domain. It's where you and I live, where we interact, where we socialize. And as a result, we're not willing, so willing today with this growing awareness, to accept anything, leftovers, as the answer for our environment. And we're looking for new answers. So tonight, rather than go into a big long lecture, what I'd like to do is show slides of some of the work that we've been doing and comment on it. Some of it's good, some of it's not so good. I'd like to talk about both sides of the issue. First, though, there is sort of an introductory period where we have the three phases of urban growth, from the country to the village and the city. Can we have the lights? I don't know where a light man is. There we go.
Thank you.
doesn't work at all. Can you hear me? No.
Ah, okay.
Hey. What you basically saw was the three phases development from the natural to the village to the city. Now, we're all designers. And in the country, the two children were playing, you were involved with the children and the fabric of the landscape. It's really a noise.
Okay.
I'm like a one-man band. Right. The second was the village, the melding of the two, the beginning of architecture. Some of the buildings were unique, some of them were quite interesting, handsome. You watched the boy, you walked through, the landscape was interesting, the natural environment. When you got to the city, it changed. How many of you can remember any of the architecture that you saw? Yet there's more architecture in a city than there is in any of the preceding two sequences. What you really were looking at were people. The boys in relation to people. At the fountain, in the downtown area, the 42nd Street area, around Rockefeller Center. And it's this kind of issue that I really want to deal with tonight. I went to Florida not too long ago to give a talk to landscape architects down there. It's not uncommon to landscape, this is not a common thing for landscape architects as much as it is for designers as a whole. I didn't know how to start the talk. How do you talk to your, you know, your fellow professionals? What do you tell them? Would you mind if I took my jacket off? It's hot in here. How do you start off a conversation with fellow professionals? Do you tell them what to do? So, and I really didn't feel like, you know, lecturing any more than I feel like lecturing tonight. This is really a lecture. I think we're past lectures. The time for lectures are gone. We really experience and take the valuable parts of it, and we assimilate it into our lives, and we come to conclusions. Well, it's the same thing down there. I don't really want to go to Florida and tell them what to do, coming from the north, especially. So I sat around, or I stood around, and I was about to do my thing, say my piece, and I still couldn't figure a good handle to get into this presentation. And they had published a booklet of the works of landscape architects in Florida. And I was glancing through this booklet, which is much too expensive for me to handle, so I was just looking through the pictures of you. Yeah, airplane stations or terminals. And I noticed that of the 30 or 40 pages of work, design, it wasn't one person in the entire book. Lots of design, no people. And that, once again, points out the issue. Sort of traveled here. So, without talking anymore, are you ready with these slides now?
Ready.
Okay, why don't you put the first slide on and see if you got the right one? You were a little out of sequence before. No, we're on the wrong one first. Try the other way. So you can get the other one going first.
Is that? No, I did it.
For those who missed the first show, the second show is about to begin. Okay.
Where are we at now? I think we just lost up the projector. Operator.
Just take the carousels and switch them. That'll be easier.
While we're waiting. There we go.
Right. Okay. Being a strong one for models out of real life, and repeating the lesson we just went through, or observation. There was a small camp, day school in East Hampton, pretty close to where you saw the other scenes. And this particular, can we have the lights off now? I think we're okay.
Yeah.
This was a panel at a farm. So the farm, as you can see, is pretty nondescript, big fields, beautiful landscape, flat landscape. And they decided as a result of a need for money that they would run a small fair. Now, what's interesting about this fair is that it really simulates a CBD, a central business district. It had many of the components, not all, but many of the components, and yet it was put together with chicken wire and graphics. The word fair has been elevated to a level that is far beyond the simple signage. It begins to have a presence of its own. The people, the way the people interact is related to the way the various booths are set up. You have dining, you have buying, you have pony rides, various kinds of entertainment. So they're mixing entertainment with shopping and dining. It's really basically what happens here is the energy of people coming together on a single afternoon for a common purpose of having a good time, which is why we do go downtown. It's not only to shop. Shopping is a basic part of our life, and it becomes a basic part of our entertainment as well. Yet what we proceed to do in most of these areas of our downtown is to dignify the downtown to the point where it no longer has the validity and the life and the energy that it once had, the fair, the carnival, the festival, the celebration. When the barter system began, it began around a large open space with the, especially in the Mideast, with the animal trainers, the acrobats. I just came back from Morocco recently, and they still have one or two of these spaces left, in Marrakesh especially. And it's an incredible experience just to be there among people. Here you get the fantasy, the clown, someone who's part of the organization, puts on a funny face and becomes something else for that time. The idea of cooking. We've cut ourselves off from our senses. We no longer smell, we barely taste. Here, you watch the man, as you would almost in a pizza parlor, make the food, you smell the food from across the field, you're involved actually in the whole process, and then you go on, even in terms of the dining, not only to eat outdoors, but to watch each other eat. It's more the interaction and the life that takes place between us that is exciting than it is the forms that we build for ourselves to look at. Shopping, the whole idea, this isn't really recycling, but it's taking goods that have a minimal value, putting them up for sale. Kids, for a nickel, enter into the adult process of buying, and in this case, even some of the kids were selling. And yet you get, even at a place like this, you get the point where there are some real needs that are satisfied in terms of clothing and other things that are made available. Here you find that the idea of mystery, fantasy, comes into play. You create a mood. Now, obviously the kid is not taken in by this gypsy here telling his fortune. He knows what it is, but he's able to let his imagination take over and enjoy himself within the context of the situation that's set up for him. This is all of these various emotional responses are part of the design process. Now, when you take what's happening here and through design elevate it into a form and an experience that really enhances and enlarges the experience of coming together, that we begin to be successful as designers. The idea of challenge. One child tests himself out against the object. The other watches. A group of others are involved. You know, it's this kind of, the various levels upon which we interact that becomes important. We have to identify this. On the right, for instance, even the humor. The oversized man and woman being photographed with a Polaroid. Just a regular Polaroid. But it's being able to really get into the spirit of things. The idea here that one paints and the other watches, the parents. They're not great artists, but it's again the fact that we interrelate to each other. You see this even more clearly in a few seconds on the bee in Central Park. Here you have another kind of space that transforms itself for a short period of time. The street becomes a theater. The parade ground comes through. The small town rewards those who do various services within the town by allowing them at various points of the year to march down this main street. They become the actors and the audience are the mothers, fathers, uncles, aunts, and friends who are then the spectators. This is the band that plays for the football games, the American Legion shows, and so forth. This is a small town of about 6,000 to 10,000 people. They need baseball players, the Little League. A fire engine. It's a volunteer fire department. And once a year, they're elevated out of their, you know, sort of workaday role into the participants of the 4th of July parade. And the mother and father goes down to watch Daddy. The street also, by the way, for that hour or two that this takes place, becomes a different kind of space. It no longer is an artery to move traffic. It becomes literally a stage setting. And when you come back to the street 2 hours later, you relate to it in a different way for a given period of time. These are real Indians, Shinnecock Indians, and then the Boy Scouts in the back. And then you come to, as I said, Bien. Now the Bien occurred some 3-4 years ago in Central Park. First it started in San Francisco. Central Park had a large space created in about 1860-65 by Olmsted. And Olmsted called it the Sheep Meadow because he literally wanted sheep to graze in this area. It's a big open space. No buildings surrounded it at the time. As a matter of fact, a landscape architect by the name of Cleveland wrote about the time that Central Park was conceived that it was not a viable idea because it was too far out of the city. Now it's enveloped by the city, and there are population density that surrounds it is incredible, considering what most of the rest of the country is like. And this space is prior to the administration of Tom Hoving, who gave the park back to the people of New York, who took the cars out of it on weekends and began to have events within the park using the open spaces as a recreation area instead of just a visual experience. Two or three people got together and decided to emulate what had gone on in Golden Gate Park. They wanted a be-in, and all that happened was by word of mouth. It was an invitation was spread around to come to the park on a Sunday just to be with other people. That's all that was to happen. Some 20, 30,000 people got together in this space. The space created the resource. The space was not designed for this kind of activity. It wasn't even conceived at the time that the space was designed. And yet, people came. This thing is out of focus, isn't it? Is that out of focus? Okay, it's out of focus for me. But they came together, and it was one of the most delightful, one of the most exciting experiences that I've ever had. And I wasn't really what you might call an active participant. I was really more of an observer. But to watch the people just coming together again, exchanging courtesies within a city, which is unique for those who have experienced the city. Coming and not being afraid of each other, large crowds, being able to talk to each other without having introductions, borrowing cigarettes or even film. And two, to watch the way people came to this space. This gets back even more definitively confirms this idea that a space can change its character by how you program it, by how it is programmed, and also by what you bring to it in terms of dress here. People are basically actors or spectators or initiators. The people who created the event were initiators. The spectators were people like myself or the nuns. Then there were the actors itself, those who were involved in some manner or form in entertaining others. The interesting thing is that here you have it. Now, no one asked these people, these two gentlemen, to come in the makeup that they had. This is the way they decided to come to this event this day. There was more actor in them than there was spectator, and more spectator in me for wanting to photograph it. And it's this kind of understanding that I think we begin to deal with. It's no longer how the dentals work on a building or how the corner details fit together. Those are important issues, but they are only important in terms of what they do for the people who participate. Now, another great space in New York that was forgotten for the better part of the last 100 years was the Bethesda Fountain. And here, and this is early in the spring, you see the two kiosks on the right and then the left. And then there is another restaurant over to the right outside of the picture. Now, this space existed from the time that the park was built. There was a fountain called the Bethesda Fountain. No one ever came here. Then they put in the restaurant. The restaurant became the catalyst, the catalytic force that really enlivened and created this as a place. Now, what happens every Saturday or Sunday, there are thousands, literally thousands of people that come through it, and many hundreds that stay to just, again, view each other. People of various economic classes, various ethnic backgrounds, and the two kiosks are for those who just want hot dogs or corn or something like this. The restaurant is for those who are more willing to pay higher prices and be more involved in regular meals. But more exciting than the food is the way the people, view each other, experience each other. Now, that's space. I showed you many different, a few different kinds of spaces, and I showed you how the space itself and the program cause the excitement. Now, on the other end of the spectrum, space alone cannot provide the experience. We were unfortunate enough, and both fortunate enough in terms of what we learned, to be involved in one of the largest housing projects in the country, Pruitt-Igoe in St. Louis. Pruitt-Igoe has 3,400 families on one large super block. What you see here are just a few of the buildings. There are 44 buildings like this one in the light tan over to the right. 44 buildings like that, all lined up in rows. There are something like six rows, 2,000 feet long. This, what you see here, is a church which backs onto the space. It's now, what exists here are basically buildings and parking and open space. Buildings only cover 25% of the land, the open space is the rest. And yet, it is one chaotic, inhuman ghetto. It's a government-sponsored ghetto, no less. This is all low-income housing. It was built about 15 years ago as a housing, publicly subsidized housing project, and it was called Pruitt and Igoe. Half was Pruitt and half was Igoe. Pruitt was, I believe, a corporal or a captain, black captain in the army. Igoe was a senator, or I may have it backwards, from St. Louis. And the senator was white, and therefore that portion of the project was supposed to be white, and the other portion was supposed to be black. Well, the awareness came just prior to having the construction finished, and they decided they had to integrate it, so it became all black. And as a result, can you hear me? Yes, for my next scene. Well, let me tell you the rest of the story while they're trying to find the light. It sounds funny on the surface, and I must admit, like I tell it in a sort of a joking way. And yet, when you get down to the real problems here, because it became all black, and because it was no longer an integrated project, and because you didn't have various economic groups in it, you have something like 12,000 people that were on not low-income people, but no-income people. No money. These most of them, better than 60% were on welfare, better than 60% had no male heads. That meant that there were no families here. Or literally, they're not literally speaking, but practically speaking, no families. Better than 60% were children. And I could go on, the statistics were staggering. And as a result, when you bring that many people together that are in this destitute situation, you create a disease, the disease of poverty. And this manifests itself, as you see here, in broken windows. They're shooting from building to building. The kids have no place to go the kids have no place to go. Vandalism is rampant. There's loads of open space, but nothing to do within the space. Which sort of brings us to the next issue. When there's no program and there's no facilities within the space, space alone can't maintain itself. And this is where the next step is a housing project in New York, which is somewhat smaller and easier to deal with than Pruitt-Igoe. From Pruitt-Igoe, we learned that you, as designers, we really cannot solve basic social problems. After we came back with a plan to the Department of Housing and Urban Development, saying that it will cost $40 million on a project that was only $60 million to start with to rehabilitate this project. But moreover, we as professionals will not underwrite our proposed design change for this, unless you were to deal with the whole issue that exist, at this particular place, and not only at this particular place, but throughout the country. We were only concerned with Pruitt-Igoe at the time, but the issue would be to deal with the social, economic, and educational needs of the people who live there, just to provide a handsome and developed design, to provide facilities alone, physical facilities, would no more answer the problem than to take any one of the other issues and deal with that alone. The problems today are so complex that we now have to deal with them comprehensively. We can't think of ourselves as, you and I, as designers, as the saviors of our cities or the saviors of our society. We're just one component, one element within the total professional discipline and governmental discipline that is necessary to handle the problem. We went, so therefore, the reason I say this is that the slides I'm going to show you now may look a lot prettier than the ones you've seen, but they only handle one aspect of the problem, and that is basic program for recreational needs. And that's nowhere near enough if you're making like $60 a week. This again is another public housing project built about 20 years ago. What happens here is this is built on the concept that, fraternal concept that if you give poor people good housing, then they should be grateful, and therefore they will respond and behave themselves. So therefore you encapsulate them in public housing projects, and you lose they will recede from your consciousness. Unfortunately, that's not quite what's happening, as we're all pretty well aware, and for various reasons. First, the paternal aspect says, we will give you what we think you need. What we think you need is a nice, pretty environment to look at. Therefore, we will give you a large panel of lawn, and that lawn will put trees. But in order to maintain that lawn, we'll put a fence around it. That fence is a chain link fence. In this case, I think it's a snow fence. Now, if you're living in this place, say, if you're living in this place, which is right, again, between 99th and 101st in Manhattan, and you look at that lawn, and you look at it, it looks like a baseball field, or it looks like a football field, it looks like a picnic area. It looks like almost anything that, that is desirable, and therefore you wish to use it. But that's not what the management says. It says you can't use it, because if you use it, you'd kill the grass, because lawn and high density just are not synonymous. Therefore, we wish to preserve the lawn and the shrubbery as opposed to those who consider the needs of those who live there. Now, to go even a step further in terms of the recreational needs, we will identify and we will deal with the ethnic backgrounds of those who come here, street people. Now, street people play a game called stoop ball. Now, stoop ball, I may have to explain to you, because it's basically a city game. You sit around the stoop. Kids sit around the stoop because that's where they live, and that's where all the activity takes place. And because they also want some kind of action, they usually have a ball called a spalding. Now, a spalding is a hairless tennis ball. And you throw that ball at the stoop, and it bounces back at you, and you catch it. And if you don't catch it, you lose. The next guy does it. It goes on. It's a rather complex game, but not a very complex game, but it's just not worth telling the whole thing now. If anybody wants to, after the session here, I'd be happy to explain the whole rules of the game. Anyway, but the reason you play stoop ball is because you want to be around that stoop. And that's because that's where the people come in and out of the building. They're walking up and down the sidewalk. And you want to be there. And you're just occupying your day, like pitching pennies or anything else. But the designer of this project, not quite understanding the full range and ramifications of this game, decides that if they play stoop ball on the street, he will build a stoop, and that's exactly what he does. So $500 or $1,000 later, he has a stoop sitting out there nowhere, right? Well, you're laughing, you see, but this designer went to the same school you did. Not Ball State necessarily, but I mean, symbolically, the same schools. This is done by professionals. The whole damn project is done by professionals. It's easy to poke fun of it. Now, we came in, right, armed to the teeth, loaded for bear. And we also cheated by putting on a black and white slide first, as well, and then right? Okay. Now, this really is out of focus. Unless I'm very close, I just can't see. Anyway, we came in, and we were seduced by the axial arrangement of the original plan. We took away a lot of the lawn areas and playgrounds, and we came up with a substitute.
turtles, concrete turtles, right? And because concrete turtles were the new contemporary play form. And if you looked up on the right, there was a little spray pool. We took away the lawn and made it, another design element. And we have seals, frogs, and I'm not sure what the other animal is. And they also were concrete. And they would squirt water. Those would squirt water. This one wouldn't. Now, you see, I was convinced at the time that we did this, which was something like 5-6 years ago, that that was nice, because these were these sculptural forms that we could use. But unfortunately, what I didn't know was that children can't relate to concrete sculptural forms that have no play value. They would mount that turtle and go nowhere and sit there and wait for something to happen. Or they'd go and mount one of the animals that squirted water when they weren't squirting water. When they squirted water, it wasn't bad, see? But why pay, say, $1,000, $1,500 for a hose ending? Because that's really the water is what they were dealing with, not the animal, see? But it took us a while, literally, it took us a while to understand that that really wasn't what play was all about. And it also took us a while to understand that these formal relationships weren't necessarily the best relationships, the actual arrangement here, for this type of living, for residential living. It was a little too monumental in scale. Looking the other way, you see that we had a stage area, there's the spray pool. We did raise the planting beds and found out that that helped. We didn't need fences in most areas. We created an amphitheater here, and we found out that the local school had its graduation ceremony in this space, using that amphitheater. Now that was a revelation. That was a real, meaningful revelation. That meant that we were breaking down the barriers of what was mine and what was yours. This was becoming now a community space. It could be used as a community space if it wasn't becoming that. They also had other situations. They had dances and things like that. And just the fact that it existed and it was paved and it could be used allowed it to be used, and it was used. Now, from Carver, which is what the name of this one, we were then given, and by the way, at the time this was done, we were all very proud. I look back at it now, I'm not quite so proud. But because of this, we were able to go on to do the next project, which is Reese. Now this is what Reese looks like, and again, another concrete form, okay, sitting out there by itself. The trees were planted, you can see how old the project is, but these trees were planted as saplings. Another axial arrangement, and in an area where there was no grade difference. Carver had a grade difference. It was up close to Harlem. Harlem was a hilly area. This is the landfill area of the East River. Now, we took this area, now having really a little more knowledge of what was going on, how people might relate to space, began to think a little more humanely about the composition than we did earlier, first breaking it down into smaller areas, a series of outdoor rooms with various activities. What you see here is way up on the left, and you'll see this more clearly in detail, is an amphitheater. Beyond that, there is a little garden area for elderly, an amphitheater. Then this is a paved and planted passive sitting area with chair benches and chess tables and so forth. And then over to the right, here outside the slide, which you'll see later again in detail, will be the playground. And now, it actually had a presence, and it also was part of a rather embryonic movement system from one street to the next. I'll go a little faster here. This is the elderly area now, just before I go into that. See, as designers, we decided to make the area for the elderly, call it for the elderly, and we nicely enclosed it. We have little slots to look out. The street exists on the behind it, as you can see, south of this. We put in a water fountain so you could hear the water and watch the water, sit on the side there, play chess, feed the flowers, and so forth. Well, that's very nice. You figure the elderly would come here and meditate and listen to the slow decomposition of their cells. Didn't quite happen, see? Didn't quite happen. Because the elderly wanted to be out where the action was. At least this economic level wanted. They were not, this was a low income, they were not intellectually oriented, they were not oriented towards a written word. They couldn't sit and read, you know, Dostoevsky in quiet, listening to the fountain. They wanted to be where the automobiles were, where they were shopping, where the kids were playing. And therefore, they didn't come into this area. Or if they did, it was on a very limited basis. Moreover, being secluded was frightening for them because they were unprotected. So So therefore, wherever that people could see them, they would be more protected. But now the housing authority got very distraught. We even offered to change the name of our drawing. We could change it from the elderly to something else. Wouldn't accept that. We told them, look, there is another group that's using the space, and that group of teenagers. We hadn't intended them to use it, but they would come in here because it was semi-private. They wanted to be a part of the whole, but yet not, you know, totally involved in it. They wanted to be observers from the outside, from the inside, looking out, so to speak. Moreover, another thing that happened here is that the teens would take this and lock this wheel up over here. And then the water would fill up a little bit higher. This water was chlorinated, by the way, which meant you couldn't really feed flowers with it. And as a result, they were blocking that up, or they would swim in it, because it was the only place that they could swim. We had spray pools, but you couldn't swim. And they couldn't go to the beaches every day, because they didn't have that kind of mobility, especially the younger ones. And in swimming in this, they would spray the water, the chlorinated water, on the flowers, and therefore the flowers would die, because chlorinated flowers don't work together. So the housing authority said, hey, let's put up a sign right here, no swimming. We said, that's not really consistent with the objectives of this place. What we would suggest is paving over. Now, again, I'm not proposing myself as an all-knowing type, but we did know that we didn't want signs, we didn't want fences. That we did know. So therefore, we looked for the alternative to that. So if they swam and kill the flowers, let's let them swim and get rid of the flowers. So we suggested that. We suggested we pave over those areas, and we did it. We were lucky. The housing authority listened to us because this project was subsidized or paid for by a foundation. Therefore, they had very little to do with it. And it worked beautifully. The kids still do swim in it. There's no harm. We didn't try to maintain an attitude, a preconceived attitude about what was good for those living here. We watched, and we took our lead in the way that people reacted. The amphitheater was very exciting. It turned out to be used 4 or 5 times a night by church groups, by mobilization for youth, by a variety of others. We hedged our bets by putting in spray pool, making it a giant spray pool as well. These are step washes and the large spray that come to the center. This was in April. This is water coming down from that fountain you saw. It also falls down through and then goes down into the lower sections too. The richness of the fabric, the place, just the design fabric, allowed the kids to interpret a lot of these. It's a balustrade. We didn't expect them to go up and down and slide on it, and yet that's what they did do. It frightened me a little, I must admit, but nevertheless, that's something, if they didn't find the challenge here, they'd find it elsewhere. Here's another case of jumping from step to step, testing out the skills against the different distances. And so we have a theory in our office that you'd be able to tell the kids in this project some 10 years from now by the fact that they'll have no front teeth. This is the passive area. See, changing in character. The lighting being very important, by the way. The lighting being probably one of the most important aspects of the entire design. Some old lady told us after it had been built, we asked, how did you like it? She says, oh, I like it very much. It's safe. Now that's really important. She didn't say, I like it very much because the concrete work is good, and the brick work is very interesting, or the shrubbery is nice. It's safe, because that's what's meaningful to her. It may not be meaningful to me as a designer, but it became meaningful to me. And therefore, projects that we did subsequent to this had a high level of lighting, because there is an inverse proportion between the amount, number of policemen you need and the amount of light you give. And I think that's very important. People prefer light to policemen. Fountain, again, for the younger kids, because they couldn't deal with the heavy use of the big spray pool. Another case where a path was being beaten down through this area, even though we had the whole place pretty much paved and pretty easy to traverse, there still were a few places that the kids and the grown-ups wanted to go. Now, again, we had the choice of about putting in the walk or a fence. We chose the walk, and you can see here, this is about a year after we did it. This is an afterthought, and it works well. Still doesn't keep them off the lawn. A fountain, again, in the beginning of the play area. Challenge again. I think we have 2 slides here. Well, I'll go on rather than try and make you work here. Here, again, in terms of a slide, instead of building a slide in the abstract by including it into a mound, not only can you get to it from 360 degrees, but you can be used in more ways than one. It's no longer a one-dimensional process. The kid in the blue, as you saw before, is my kid. And I used to bring him to all these playgrounds to test it out. He's actually 32 years old. Here you see the way these arch climbers link one mound form to another. Here's another little interesting thing here. I think we may see it again later, I'm not sure. This thing here is a hole that goes to the center of the mound. There are three of them, three tunnels going to the center. You climb up. So not only can you get to this thing from 360 degrees, you can also get it from 363 degrees because of the two, three ways. Now, when we first put this in, we were told, hey, listen, that's pretty dangerous. And I must admit, I was frightened as well. I said, yeah, it is pretty dangerous. What do we do? So how about putting gates on it and they can lock it at night? See this thing over here? Probably can't see it. There's a hatch or a metal element over here. And when we wanted the gate, we'd come up and clip onto the cantilever concrete form. And they would, at night, they'd come and lock it up. So we ordered the gates, because this was a private job, we could do that. We ordered the gates and one on the top. About two, 3 weeks later, after the place had been almost complete, the contractor put the gates on. The next morning, they were all gone. There wasn't one left. They were making a statement. They were telling us that they didn't want it. That was the only place in the entire project that we put a gate or a fence on. And they didn't want it. But what we did have is we had a lot of, you know, things happen in those tunnels. Like, we find a mattress in there every so often. We call that team play, you see? It's team play. And that's not so bad, because in the morning it would be taken care of. See, when the younger kids found a mattress, they'd push it to the center and then they'd set it on fire. That's called creative play. Anyway, this is another game that the older kids play. These three guys stand over here. The other one stands on the end, like on a diving board, and jumps onto the mound. A few deformities came out of that game, but here's that same tunnel again. There you can see. There's the hasp. It also became the local laboratory, which was a local. So they actually had to go and build one afterwards, which I think is important. Again, understanding the fact that we do have biological functional needs that have to be satisfied. You go to the bathroom. Originally we thought that because the kids would come out of their homes, they wouldn't need a bathroom. But if you know anything about kids, and I now do because I own two of them, you find out that they have to go to the bathroom 1 second before and no sooner. They don't know it until it's too late, almost. So therefore, they can't wait to get in that go to the building, get in that elevator, and then go up whatever how many flights it is. So but the Housing Authority finally, after some pressure, decided that they would put a laboratory in. Now this, again, deals with something that I've been talking about but haven't defined verbally. There is a coercive and a permissive design approach. The fence in the background is the coercive. It tells you what to do. It doesn't intimate anything, it's not subtle, it just forces you into a pattern. Somebody's preconceived ideas about the way you must behave. The wall here is an edge to the playground, the back edge. Whether you like the graphics or not, that's not really the issue. It is an integral part of the design, and yet it is a barrier. It's not the kind of barrier that the fence is, but we didn't need that kind of barrier. We couldn't take the fence down because the Housing Authority wouldn't allow us to. Now, with the wall, you see, if you took the wall away, the design would be diminished. And if you took the fence away, the design would be enhanced. I think those are the criteria you begin to use in terms of design. If what you have is extraneous to the design, then it's not, it's maybe important in terms of the function, but it's not important in terms of the design. Therefore, you look for another solution that is an organic part of the design. Another playground a playground, part of a school. We deal with housing as one issue. Now we'll talk about various other spaces in the city. Now, I will go a little faster, or I could be here all night. So, Steve, I won't explain all the slides. We'll just look at them for a few minutes as we go by. But this is a schoolyard. This is added. They were going to put two tennis courts in. We suggested, again under a grant, that we put in a basketball court here, as you see, the press, so we don't need a fence around it, say, by the time you finish here with it. A wall that is, say, 6-7 feet high here, another 2 feet for the parapet, and a small rail on top. You're up the 9-10 feet that you need. The graphics, and then that's for the teenagers. These here are buildings, recreation buildings, and comfort stations, and even a snack bar, and then the play part of it. So instead of making it a school playground, it became a community playground, community facility. It also has a spray facility in it. You see here. Closer view with the city park. Eventually, when those trees grow, they'll canopy over it. This is the opening ceremony in which the kids, the school, came out and used the space. This is the other side looking back. Now, here I would just as a comment from a design point of view, we got quite almost carried away here, and we have the vocabulary, the design vocabulary is much too rich, much too different too. The concrete, the wood, the cobblestone, just we didn't need, in order to get this, and then the cables here, we didn't need all that many, we needed those activities, didn't need that many different materials. Again, in retrospect, it's not bad. The kids use it, they like it. But from a design standpoint, I think it could have been simpler. Could you just try and focus that? That's okay, better, good. You can see it even here. But what is important about it, which I'd like to comment on, is the idea that this playground is linked, meaning the forms on the far right are linked by a bridge to the concrete elements over here. And you can jump to this point here or pick up on the cables. Then from here, I believe you come across another bridge, and you come across another bridge. And the reason for that is that play is a continuous activity. It doesn't stop, start. You move from one element to another. It's a series of choices, and those choices are given to the children to make, and they are not the designer's option. You can set up the choices. That can be your option. But in terms of how they're used, I think there has to be a greater freedom. And even these playgrounds, by the way, are much too rigid. Because in the final analysis, the playground should be made by the child. We should provide the resources for the child. We should provide the elements that by which he can build his own playground, modify it, change it from day to day, leave it different from the way he came. Here is another, thanks. Here is another game we provided, which I think will do something to control the population growth in this area. And then take a cable that comes down to a hairpin kind of pipe, and you grab that cable and rope on that cable, hold it over your head, pull your feet off the ground, slide down to the bottom, yelling Geronimo. Now, from the schoolyard, talking about the Vestpocket Park, which came into play, came into public consciousness an explosion, and then sort of fizzled out like a dead firecracker. And the reason is that if it's a political issue, many lots within a city are available, like this one, for recreational purposes. And therefore they said, well, the Vestpocket Park. But we got involved in it, and the first time around, I had, again, this crusading idea that I would, advocate these Vestpocket Parks, and I would help build them, and I spent some of my Saturdays and Sundays actually out there in this neighborhood in Bedford-Stuyvesant building this park, a rather crude little park. Now, what we also did, though, was kind of interesting. We first started off with the idea that it would be self-help programs. Self-help means that those in the community come out and on their spare time help build the facilities. Now, you don't go to the rich part of town and say, hey, boys, come on, it's Saturday or Sunday, let's go out and build a little park. Because you get no response. And you don't go to a middle-income area either. But somehow, the notion, the Protestant ethic brought us to the conclusion that you go to a poor area, and the way that poor people lift themselves up by their bootstraps is by building little Vestpocket parks. Well, unfortunately, and we learned this very quickly, unfortunately, poor people had nothing but their labor to sell. And to ask them to give it away is an insidious request. And the kind of cooperation we got, people were very interested, but they just couldn't afford the time, literally could not afford the time to build it. We then came to the conclusion that if we wanted it built, we would have to pay for it. And not a bad idea, because if we were going to pay, we also thought at that time, after having learned the initial lesson, that we would pay an adequate salary. Now, this carpenter here was getting $5 or $6 an hour for his time. He was I knew the man. He had worked on another project. But he is a competent carpenter. The laborers, or those who didn't have the kind of skills that he had, would get about $4 an hour. Now, what was interesting about this is that we didn't lose a day's work out of any of these men. Once you provided a proper and adequate salary, one that was dignified, they would respond to it in a dignified and a responsible way. And we found this out in two cases. We also found out that the teenagers didn't need the kind of salary that the men required. But they could be satisfied with $1, $1.25, because their needs were different and their basic attitudes were different. So here you had the teenagers fixing this up. We also learned, too, that you don't take secondhand materials, or so-called pre-deteriorated materials into a deteriorating neighborhood, because it's not going to solve anything. What you really, and this is, in this case here, we did just that. You can see these crummy boards. Now we started to get some new stuff. But you really want to elevate those who live in the neighborhood. So if you come in and build a park out of scraps and bits and pieces, it looks like scraps and bits and pieces. It doesn't really, I make for greater identity. So the teenagers here were working, painting, and so forth. They were very happy to make whatever they made. On the other hand, the preteens or the kids just wanted the experience. They found building this park a recreational experience. And in this case, I was painting one Saturday, and a kid comes to the hate wall. By this time, they knew me. By the way, one other thing. There wasn't one thing stolen out of this park while it was being built, which I found quite interesting, because I had been warned to be very careful. This kid comes up, Paul, can I paint? And I said, Jesus, to myself, yeah. You paint, you'll crap up the whole park, you know? Then I thought to myself, but whose park is it? It's not my park. So I said, okay, and I gave him like 1 square foot to paint, very carefully. And I gave him my paintbrush and my pail. Within seconds, there were like 20 pails around. Within seconds, there was a swarm of kids. Each kid grabbed a pail, and they started painting all over the place. And they did a reasonably good job, after all, you know. Here's another situation. This was done by the Pratt students, a mural painted by the Pratt students. And there were better ones done in other parks. This one, I don't think, is one of the best. But what was interesting here is that these things, these circles, at the last minute they came up, you can see it on the other orange there, and they put a big blob of orange in here, and it drooled down over the blue. And these two little girls were watching this. That's the last thing they did. Somehow they wanted the spontaneity or something. And these two kids were watching, and all of a sudden, the painters, the artists left, they took blue paint and they cleaned it up, took away the dribbles. They didn't want their mural to be crapped up. And they had a point of view. They had developed an attitude. Making that kind of contact, I think, is, it's not profound, but I think it's important just to be able to do that. Here is another mural, another color. But what's also interesting about these murals is that it allows artists, art students, to come out and test out some of the things at a larger scale. Now, from that, which was the individually designed playground, we decided that in these best pocket parks, you couldn't do it because it just wasn't economically feasible for the office nor the community. So we developed, under a HUD grant, 3 or 4 different modular systems which would allow any designer and almost any community to almost create their own little best pocketed situation. Moreover, these things have no foundations, therefore they can be moved at the time after the land is going to be used for another purpose. This is another one here. We notice we also try and work with artists on all of these. The plaques were done and the fence mural on the back. That's a fence, that's a kinetic piece with a fence in front of a silkscreen piece. This is the concrete elements again, which is another element of it. There were 4 things that came out of it: pipe and cable, concrete, wood, and the tubular steel. Now, this is not the city, but just to show you another one of the systems, these are the heavy 12 by 12 timbers, and also how you can deal with playgrounds and art, but they don't have to look like bizarre, out-of-space creation. This is something that was done on the waterfront at Mamaroneck, Long Island. On the Westchester Shore. And you can see here how it integrates with the sand and the water and the rock. for a private party. Again, modular. Now, so far we've talked about housing projects, we've talked about the playgrounds, we've talked about empty lots. This is the street. The street also can be another priority. This is the Bedford-Stuyvesant superblock that was mentioned earlier, and it took the center of the street and changed its use to a park, a 200 by 70 foot park, right where the people live and where they need it. This again is Bedford-Stuyvesant, a street-oriented community. This is in the winter time, that's why it looks so drab. Looks drab in the summertime too, but. Playground, 30 by 30, small playground, but dealing with play in a vertical sense. This thing will take 50 kids. A water fountain here, water trough comes down into this area. These spray, water, and clean park. There'll be housing over there eventually. On the other street, we didn't need two street closings. We wanted the traffic to go through. We raised the street in two places to the same elevation as the sidewalk. Therefore, the car coming down the street had to slow down or else break an axle or something. But basically, it tied the sidewalks together and created a pedestrian orientation for the street. You can see it better. Not necessarily the only answer, just an answer. Now we get to the point where you begin to tie all these elements together, hopefully. I showed you a series of fragments, and then we were lucky enough to have the opportunity to work on the first state park in the city. By the way, if at this point you feel you'd like to take a break for 5 or 10 minutes, I'd be happy if you just keep going. Okay, I think you said keep going. Here. Those who are awake. Anyway, so what happens here, we were given a commission as landscape architects by the State Park Commission to study the east side of the Harlem River to see how it could be, how it might be used for a park. We came back and said, no, I don't think a park is adequate, because if you look at this area, you see that it's separated from the main part of the Bronx by highways. It's junky right now by highways and railroads, and there's escarpment. You'll see better what I'm talking about here. There's the highway, it's the part of one wall, and the park area is down to the right. You can see the railroad over there too. So we came back and said, look, what we would prefer as designers, that you think of this as a series of communities. Note the point that each of the railroad stations, you create a community with housing, educational facilities, recreational facilities, and that the recreational facilities becomes the park. And this interaction, interrelationship with the various elements, like the housing, this is all park in here. There's the housing, there's the school, more housing there. The housing populates the park. There's the recreation building there, so the housing doesn't have to build its own community center. The school can use the park land. It's this kind of trade-off that becomes really important, the idea of a comprehensive approach. Therefore, we need less land for housing, less land, therefore, more land for the park. We need less land to develop the housing as well. Therefore, the land, same people will use the park, therefore we can use in the park. Same thing with the school. No duplication, no waste. And moreover, because of that, we can increase the amount of facilities that we can provide at various levels. The school could provide an auditorium or a shop for this little community. No, this would have 2,000 families in it. And the ability, with the swimming pool, which you see over here, the ability to take on another, say, 4,000 or 5,000, 6,000 people on weekends. Here's the center with the community building. You can see the pool area. Eventually, it'll be a promenade along the entire valley. I don't think that these towers are the most appropriate form of architecture for this thing. Unfortunately, it was the only thing we were allowed to build. We didn't design this, but the only thing that was allowed to be built at the time because of political reasons. The reason for this flat facade of the building is that you have a projection system built in on this side. You can run a movie at a moment's notice. You can have ice skating or roller skating. In other words, creating a facility that could be changed without great effort. We tried to put on a movie in Central Park once, and it was going to cost us something like $15,000 just to put on a movie. This is what the first phase would look like from the other side of the river. And a close-up of it right here, the pool area. Recreation building, Barry. This is now dealing with the design vertically. You know, it's the steps. We only have about 500 feet from the edge of the water to the railroad. So we had to deal with it vertically, meaning various levels, overlooks and underlooks. Now, going a step further, this is the most comprehensive plan that we have been involved in. What was interesting is that the developer came to us as landscape architects, because traditionally, developers need to go to architects. But because this developer wanted a different orientation, he did not want a building orientation to start with, he asked us to review it in terms of its recreational social needs requirements. Now, what you see here outlined in this red are two sites. One is the Goodrich rubber site and the old arsenal site in Watertown, Massachusetts, right outside of Boston on the river right here. I'm sorry. This is the Goodrich site. Here. This is the arsenal site. This is the Charles River. We came up with a plan which was open space oriented. Now that doesn't mean parks. If you'll notice, even on the Harlem River, the kind of park we're talking about are urban parks. Only this one, because it was so comprehensive, and because it was became an integral part of the downtown area of Watertown. First, the developer was a shopping center developer. Therefore, he wanted 1 million square feet of shopping, a regional shopping center. That gave it its economic base. It also gave us an opportunity to develop streets, covered streets, within the shopping center, and a covered piazza, which you'll see in a moment. We're picking up the MDC park system. We enveloped the proposed project with a green park separating it, giving it identity, and moreover, allowing the older neighborhoods to interface more easily, rather than coming right up against it, to have this transitional green space. Then we put our new houses in these brown areas in urban streets on the outside, going down and various levels up. And the community spaces in blue were at these nodal points, the cross section. These community spaces were now schools, but they weren't schools as such. They were going to be, because a school has shops, because a school has auditoriums, gymnasiums, classrooms, cafeterias, it really has all of the increments necessary to build, that you would use in building a community center. And a community center is basically used at night and on the weekends when the school is not used. So we felt that the school should have a different kind of orientation. This then is the plan, which instead of dwelling on it, we'll go on. I'll show you the pictures, which are more exciting. The model. Using the river, too. Plaza coming up through main space inside, and the exterior spaces as well. This has various options. This is one of the little housing enclaves off of the shopping area. But what's interesting here is that the people who live here now have the option to be in an urban area, highly developed urban area. That's the urban street system. To be in enclosed streets, an enclosed environment during the winter and summer. To take full use of the park-like space, the green park that surrounds it, or to come into their own little private spaces. That is really where design is going to, providing various options, various alternatives to those who live there. Again, I'm not proposing the design as exemplary as much as I think the concepts are important. I think the concepts presage a new way of thinking in terms of what our responsibilities might be. This is the waterfront piazza with the boutiques and restaurants tying back into the main shopping area, and this is the main space of the shopping. Now this really is the heart of that neighborhood. It'll be a place that people will come to for theaters, for shopping, for just for browsing, looking around. Something to do. Let's take a walk downtown. Montreal, the Place Ville Marie, gets something like 20 to 30,000 people on a Sunday. On a Sunday when the stores aren't even open. This is another picking up on that concept, something that we actually did do, the enclosed mall in Worcester, Massachusetts. It's something like, I guess, about 1,000 feet long, and it's now going to be the place within the city of Worcester. It has fountains and the stores along the side. This was on opening day. But it's an enclosed space. It's revitalizing the downtown, giving it a different kind of meaning. Picking up on what the shopping center provides for. It's a shopping center, the great nemesis of all of us. It's really
could really teach us a very important lesson. It's draining the downtown of its energy, its economic energy, because people want the convenience, they want the kind of excitement that these places offer. Therefore, picking on the shopping center as a model, I think we can learn an awful lot. This deals now with a different concept, by the way, the idea that design can actually have an economic value. We were asked by these developers of the shopping center to take one space that they had back by the garage and off of the mall outside and deal with it so that it might have an economic return. We provided them one design earlier, which they rejected because it was very pretty, they said, but didn't have, unfortunately, they couldn't afford to pay for it. So then they said, if you can come up with an idea that might have an economic value, we would be interested. So we took the difference in elevation between this ramp coming down, and we terraced it off into a series of levels, as you see here, using water fountains and pack systems to come down, created these boutique kiosks, and what happens is, back in here, there's a line where you have 10 foot headroom through the whole back part, creating 8,000 to 10,000 square feet of shopping underneath this, coming in through these boutiques, and a restaurant down in here. This is just a model of it. Now, this will be built. They are now, right now, trying to find a tenant for this space, the kind of space that they were, the kind of tenant they would look for would be a ski shop, sport shop, something on that order, or restaurants. But it's that kind, it's a new kind of relationship where we, as professionals, become development consultants. Another situation similar to that is a park in New York, right off of the UN, and here we propose to the city, under a grant from a foundation, that they put in an adult park with an exhibit area in here. And from the model, you see a restaurant. Underneath it is parking, which then pays, by the way, the parking alone will pay for the entire development that you see here. The fountain in the center or pool converts into an ice skating rink in the winter time, strictly oriented towards adults. Makes money, will provide, like the Bethesda Fountain, will provide an income back to the city. Another very important concept today. Now, just sort of random thoughts, just sort of tying this up. Another, we were asked by Con Edison to deal with this mess that they had created, and they wanted us to come back and create a natural landscape. And this is where they're putting in the nuclear power plant. The power plant is really quite beautiful, although it's questionable as to its environmental quality. But it's big engineering forms. And so after mastering enough, I guess they came back and said, would you please provide us with a master plan? And also locate a building where we would have, where it would be an exhibit building for the operation that we have here. We would bring people up to it. And they gave us a square foot area of the building, about 10,000 square feet. Now, we're landscape architects. And we thought, in terms of just relationships, that if you took a little building of 10,000 square feet and put it next to these giant engineering forms that look like a pimple on the rear end of an elephant. So we came back to them and said, you know, we would like to propose something else, something more, instead of trying to rehabilitate this area and try and recreate nature, it would be virtually impossible. Why don't we create an energy park? A park that is in scale with the facility that's in orange over there. And what we would do here is, using these spoils, the earth spoils that you have, the excess earth, create a series of large outdoor rooms with these berms, and then a space frame structure in the somewhere located in this. And you, again, a non-building, just a roof. They were intrigued by the idea and asked us to develop it further. And these renderings are listed. We were attempting to deal with the ecological problem of thermal pollution until we realized that we came up with this proposal, and then they gave us the numbers, and they literally have to run a river through the plant in order to cool the water. So this little fountain we were proposing would be like, you know, a bit like an eyedropper in comparison to what we needed. This is then what the building would look like, a mirrored glass enclosed space frame. The building is actually in the mound itself, as you can see from the inside here. You can see the form here is similar to the shopping center. This came first. But this whole building then became the exhibit as well. In other words, the lighting and else became integral. So we really, what it amounts to is an indoor landscape. These are brick berms that come down.
you break into and put with the forms, the steps, and bridges, and so forth, really an indoor landscape in which is nothing more than an extension of what you see outside. By the way, another interesting part about that is that the cost per square foot of this building was like a third of what would normally cost them to deal with a regular building. That intrigued them also. We also were fortunate enough to work on the U.S. Pavilion in Osaka with Davis Brody, architects. The outside is a non-building again. I seem to get involved with non-buildings. Just an inflatable roof structure with this earth berm. And on the inside, that we were discussing what material would we use on the inside in this hollow, this bowl shape. And we're talking about exposed aggregate. Somehow you don't go to Japan and use exposed aggregate. You know, that the quality of the work over there is so fantastic. And if this is going to be an exhibit building, you want something more dramatic. We proposed this and was used mylar paving. Now, you don't really walk on it. These are the platforms. But this whole inside was, and the reason I bring this up is that we are now at a point where we can begin to think of new materials. We don't necessarily have to go back to the old standard forms of asphalt, concrete, brick, and so on. We can really think in terms of steel, reflective steels, a mylar here because it's indoors. And what happens now is that when the sun comes down, the movement of the people reflects in it and it shimmers and the activity of the place increases because of the interaction between the material and the people. And at night, the reverse happens. The lighting of the place is amplified by the reflective quality, and therefore the dome itself, the roof, becomes much more, much brighter and much more exciting. Carrying that same process a little bit further, a park that we designed, a very urban park in the Wall Street area of Manhattan, and it will be built probably over the next year and a half. Here's where the water fall and a series of step forms, and it's a very small park, about an acre and a half. And the reason we use step forms is because it has this tremendous surge period at lunchtime and after work where people come out and we'd like to sit down for a while, but you can't provide the number of benches that are required. So we provide, instead of benches, we use steps. We also use the stainless steel cylinders, reflective steel, highly polished stainless steel, as a sculptural quality and also for this reflective quality. One or two people can populate this park. A little bit of light can bounce off and create quite an exciting situation. You can see how the steps work, creating an amphitheater as well, an informal amphitheater which could be used where they have any kind of program. They shut the water off on that platform in the center, water drains off, it can be used as a stage. The idea of multiple use. On the upper level of the same park on the other side of the building. By the way, there are some buildings related to this park. The tall, just for your information, the tallest and the biggest office building in the world, other than the World Trade Center. So, but being a landscape architect, you know, I rarely include buildings. So here we have a waterfall which encloses the space and overlooks the, and it has an outdoor dining facility. Now, we were also asked by an impresario or a producer to look at a parking lot, and collaboration with him, come up with an idea of how that parking lot might be used for income, to produce income, other than as a parking lot. And he was commissioned by the city to do this. So we came up with what we call a video park. Now, we all have a rather demeaning attitude towards video or TV, and yet environmental artists are using it as a new form, as they would paint or bronze or casting and so forth. And what they find is that by including the audience into the program, by the immediacy of the program, that they can get a different dimension of experience. It's not the same kind of video that you experience when you come home at night, but it's using it environmentally. Like this room here, if it had, say, 50 TV sets, some of which were playing the same program, some of which were actually dealing with the audience, you are capable of taking in, through your eyes, much more information than you can through any other of your sense organs. Therefore, and almost simultaneously. And this is what video begins to do. There is a Global Village production in Greenwich Village which deals with that. They have something like 25 sets in a room, 25 by, I think, 75, And it's an incredible, they had the Woodstock performance, an incredible experience to watch TV. They had Martin, they interjected other things with it and began to actually score the various sets. And you sat there and you became selective. Well, this is what we proposed here. Using trailers, these are components. These are trailers, it would be a movable park. And these various elements. It never got off the ground. These are modular and incremental. Now, you see the value of this by what happened in Central Park when they first landed on the moon. The moonwalk, they had this large projected image of the moonwalk. It was at night. You can see here that people, it was raining, and yet they got a crowd of 10,000 people to come to the park to watch TV together. So, I'm sure that the majority of those people could have watched TV at home. We got the same program, ABC, but they wanted to share this experience together, and the TV allowed them to do that. The immediacy of landing on the moon, the idea that news actually became entertainment for these people, and getting together and sharing this experience was something that would bring them out in the rain in the middle of the night. Again, this talks about programming, using the night, the spaces at night, in Central Park, with a light show, using the searchlights, taking the Bethesda Fountain that you saw before, and this was Torfield, Marvin Torfield, who's an environmental artist, using steam and light, took the Bethesda Fountain, to see here, for two nights, and changed its character. Well, that's about all I have tonight. I would be happy to stay on and answer any questions. Thank you.